to call our meeting to order. And tonight, we're operating a little bit under duress to try to explain the situation. Normally, our meetings occur up in chambers, and our meeting is normally the third Tuesday. Our regular meeting is normally the third Tuesday of the month, which is fairly well recognized. Unfortunately, tonight, there is a, as I understand it, a special emergency school board meeting, and we agreed to give up our normal meeting area to the school board so they could have their meeting on camera. I am, for record, sending a note to the town council indicating our displeasure with that. We do certainly not want to see it become a regular practice, because I know there are a number of people in town that are looking, not necessarily look forward to the planning board meeting like they would a soap opera, but they do look forward to keeping track of what we do. And this is, to a certain extent, is going to hamper that activity, even though we will be on tape and broadcast tomorrow night. So I do apologize for our meetings down here. Now, this is going to present some difficulties for both the planning board and for people that will be testifying before us tonight. You'll notice I'm trying to raise my voice somewhat. We are unfortunately able to use only a single low-tech tape recorder. Therefore, what I will request for people that are making presentations before us, that either you come and bring that chair as close to the post or as close to this item as possible. If you want to sit, that's perfectly all right, but speak loudly, because all we're going to have to go on is the tape. And if the voices are too soft, we will not get you on tape. So once again, I apologize for this. It's not within our control. A few small announcements. We do have a new member, Judy Lardner, who was appointed at the last town council meeting. Judy cannot be with us tonight. She's out of town. But she will be at our next regular meeting, probably a workshop, and we look forward to having her join us. So the planning board is back up for a full complement of five members and two alternates, which is good to have. At this time, I'd like to go over any correspondence that came in that was not part of our package. Is there any? There is none. Okay. Then at this time, I would like to have a review of our minutes of our prior meeting. Has there been an opportunity by the members to review our minutes of our prior meeting? And are there any comments on those minutes? Hearing none, I would entertain a motion to accept the minutes.
I so move.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor, signify by raising their hand. Opposed? Passed. The minutes are accepted. The first item on our agenda for tonight is a hearing, which I will now open. Concerns a proposed amendment to section 19-4-7A2 of the Cape Elizabeth zoning ordinance regarding the deadline for filing of variances and public hearings. And I just want to see if we can get a reading on that. Basically, we're changing the filing time from 30 days, which is mentioned in the zoning appeals section 19-4-7. We're changing it are we going from 90? It's now 90 down to 30? Or is it up 30 up to 90?
Now 90.
Now 90.
It's now 90, it's going down to 30.
No.
It's the other way.
The other way. 30 is going up to 90. Okay.
Yeah.
This is the grant variances from the terms of this ordinance where only the conditions preclude any property and not the result of actions of the applicant. So basically, this is for filing variances between the zoning board. 30 days or 90 days. Is there anybody here from the public that would like to speak to this issue? Okay, are there any members of the planning board that would like to speak to this issue?
Huh? It's not my understanding I'm going to vote on this issue.
Let's see. We have one.
Doesn't matter, I have no comment.
Okay, so I guess the answer would be no on this item. No comments? Then I would entertain a motion from the board to assess this variance. Change the ordinance.
So moved.
So moved, second.
I'll second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor, signify by raising your hand. It passes, and the hearing is closed. Can we pass this on to the town council? Planning board has passed this change in zoning appeals ordinance procedures. Okay. Next item on our agenda is the, Kevin Zorsky, LC Tybino, request for public access waiver for one lot on Beacon Lane, map U15, lot 66. We're now under section 19-4-2B. This is for public access waiver. Is there a representative of the Zorsky Tybino?
Yes, there is.
Application? You might want to come forward here as I mention, because we're not going to hear you from here, ended up.
Pull closer here.
Would you please?
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
As I have in the past, because I'm acquainted with the applicant, I'll have to refrain from voting or anticipating.
Mr. Emery, and you will be? Okay, Mr. Emery, I would like to appoint you as a voting member on this issue. And we do have four, so we are set as far as a form is concerned. We have had a chance, I think at least Steve and I have had a chance to walk your property, and I don't know whether any of the other people voting have had a chance to take a look at it. It might not be a bad idea to just review the major issues and what has been accomplished since we walked it. I know we had some issues related to access and width of access. We also had some issues related to turnaround, single point of entry instead of a drive, which we now understand the way it's going to be done. And we also had a real question on site distances. So maybe at this time you might want to review those three important issues and see where we stand on those.
Well, at the time of the sidewalk, I was told that it would be, I needed to get a site survey done for site distance where Beacon Lane comes out onto Two Lakes River. And that was done in early August. And it was also done by the police department. Police department survey was done, I believe, on July 30th. And on July 31st and on August 1st, I went out to the site, and after talking with the neighbors, consulting with them, I cleared some shrubbery on either side, looking both east and west.
This would be on Two Lakes Road?
Yes, along Two Lakes Road. And that significantly improve the site distance. So there's going to be a discrepancy between the professional survey and what the police department reported. My survey, the surveyor who did the survey for me, did it at the requested 26 feet from the center of the road, from the center of Two Lights Road, and then also did it at a shorter distance for the easterly looking east, which is looking towards the Lodge of Shack. And when you're 26 feet off the road, you're quite a bit, the front of your car will be quite a bit back off the road, but that's what how the ordinance reads, and that's where you took it from. The front of your road, then, the front of your car might be, even a big car might be, the driver's seat might be 8 feet, say, in a big Cadillac or something. And this was, when you're 26 feet back off the center of the road, you're 15 feet back off the edge of the pavement. Anyway, at 26 feet, you can see 158 feet. And when he moved it up to 21 feet, which would be 10 feet from the end of the pavement, you can see 345 feet. And he describes it in his report that you can start to see the car at 345 feet, and then it's either partially obscured or totally obscured, depending on where in the lane the car is traveling.
Obscured by what?
By some bushes there.
Bushes.
So if they're hugging the middle of the road, the center lane, the centermost part of the road, they're they don't disappear from view, but if they're hugging the outside of the road, they partially obscure it by these bushes.
And has this been sketched? I'm looking through my packet. I've got a plot plan, but have you sketched this on?
I sketched it out originally when I did the survey, way back when. And it shows, I don't know if you have that with you or not, but it shows that there are bushes there that would tend to obscure the view. When I did that, it was in the winter, and they really didn't obscure it. They didn't sound like that. Anyway, as it talks about it in the report that the surveyor did, these bushes are on the public way. They're about 6 feet off of the pavement. And I trimmed them back a bit after talking to the owner of the property. And there was no, she said it was fine to do that. But I was reluctant to cut down the whole thing because it's a pretty big, good-sized bush. Looking the other way, looking west, away from the lava shaft, the limiting factor is a knoll of dirt off of the road and quite close to the intersection. And the surveyor figured out that if that knoll was dropped a foot, that the site distance could be much more than adequate.
Where is that knoll? Is it in the right-of-way?
It's in the right-of-way also.
It's in public?
Yes, it's in the public right-of-way. Let me go check the stuff for it. The knoll is, the lilac bushes are 7 feet from the edge of the pavement. And the knoll would be 6 or 7 feet off the pavement. It's just off the pavement. I don't think he makes reference to how far off the pavement he is. It's 21 feet, 17 feet west of the utility pole. Oh, 18 feet from the center of the pavement. So that's, again, 7 feet. The pavement's about 22 feet. So it's, again, 7 feet off the pavement. And I believe that the right-of-way there is 40 feet. I didn't check that, but that's the standard right-of-way.
So it's within the right-of-way, 7 feet
yes.
up, and it would have to be removed from the site distance.
Right.
Without it, what is the site distance?
Without it, the site distance, looking west, is about 231 feet.
So that's right at a speed limit change, isn't it?
Right. The speed limit change is, if you're traveling east towards the Lobster Shack, the speed limit there's a sign just before you hit the
drop.
Right.
What was the speed measured? Do you have a report on speed measurements?
The average speeds per day varied from 28 miles per hour up to a little more than 32 miles per hour. And that reflected the transitional nature of that area, that you had people either slowing down from 35 to 25 or speeding up from 25 to 35, depending upon what direction they were going. So in terms of speed, that wasn't felt to be a major factor. It didn't seem like people were driving at excessive speeds on average.
On average, yeah.
However, when it comes to sight distance, you find you to look at least 32 miles per hour in a baseline.
We go 10 feet per mile per hour, we're talking about at least a minimum of 20 feet. And you have, with the knoll there, you have how much?
With the knoll there now?
Yeah.
It's 231 feet looking west.
West, and how much looking east?
158 feet, 26 feet back, and 345 feet when you get a little closer, 21 feet from the center.
By the ordinance.
By the ordinance, 158 feet. And those two would both, by eliminating those lilac bushes and by lowering that knoll, least to over 300.
It would be over 300.
When you say it would increase to
300. Over 300 by the ordinance? Way of measuring?
Yes, from 26 feet back, which is the ordinance. If the lilac bushes were removed, we'd get 345 feet looking west. And 360 feet looking east.
Make it adequate.
Right. So I guess where that stands is, you know, I didn't want to get a backhoe out there and start digging up town property, but if the town would like to have improved site distance there, I think that can be done without, you know, getting into any kind of legal problems if the town gave us permission. But I'd like to add that I feel that the site distance is really not too bad now relative to a lot of existing roads in Cable Isn't. You have pretty good site distance there. There's never been an accident. If the planning board sees fit that you know, I should get that, yeah, you know, the ordinance distances, I think can be done.
Now, fortunately, from my perspective, we have two issues here. Number one, we have an ordinance in effect. It's been in effect for a reason. It's not just an arbitrary ordinance. It goes according to some standards set by the Traffic Association. And it's been pretty well tested. So that's one item. The other item is that is a tough intersection. The way it looks at the moment, it's not an easy one. And the dependence on keeping shrubbery trimmed is problematic. We've had that problem before. Unfortunately, nature being what it is, the trees grow fast. So that's a problem. Removing a knoll is a little bit more permanent once you get in and take a backhoe. Remove the knoll, it's gone, which is more permanent to fix the problem.
Well, the bushes in question, if they were removed, they'd be removed. They're 10 feet tall. It's a big thing. And they're probably 8 feet wide by 3 feet wide. It's a big clump of tall lilac bushes.
Planted on the right of way.
Yes. So it wouldn't be that they, you know, that wouldn't be a problem in growing back if they were
removed. If they were removed, that's correct.
Right.
Yeah. Trimming them a little bit.
I trimmed them just, you know, to get some site distance.
But your proposal would be to remove the lilac bushes.
If the town sees fit, that would be fine. I mean, that's not a problem. The knoll is, I have to hire a backhoe.
Yeah.
A lilac, I could.
Wouldn't if be not, if it's not, you'd have to come before us to look for a variance of site distance requirement.
Yeah, that'd be.
I, for one, would not like to see that happen from a safety point. Any other questions on the site distance issue?
Mr. Chairman, the police department has gone back and looked at the site distance issue after the engineer's letter had come. And we have that, was that on the table tonight? In which they talked about the removal of the knoll and a drop in the surface of the ground some 15 inches from the travel way. I don't know if you've seen that letter. I'm going to take a look at it so you can react to it. The police department is saying that a guardrail will have to be installed if that knoll is removed, and that is a dangerous situation by itself. But have some comment on that by the applicant.
I disagree with what they're saying, because the knoll is off, is raised off of the road level, and it dropped 15 feet. I don't understand what they're saying. This means that the right next to the road would be a 15-inch drop-off. It wouldn't even be down to the level of the road. The road itself is not too high. It's this knoll.
Is the knoll in the road, or is it?
No, the knoll is not on the road. It's off to the side. The road is, you know, has a curve to it, and there's a small way you come up off of it. This is not accurate. I don't know what else to say about it. There is ledge there, and that's why I would need a backlight. This could be like a shoulder. But I can't see why a guardrail would be needed. It wouldn't be lower than a pavement.
You can notice the last paragraph of Coleman Dyer's.
Yeah.
Mr. Chairman, Just another issue that came up, and the applicant has a response, is that neither the Cape Elizabeth Police Department nor the applicant's engineer talked about the fact that Two Lights Road, looking in a westerly fashion, dips down in the roadway itself to a point that there's a partial loss of sight distance. I'm not sure that's affected by the null or not.
Within the 350-foot distance?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a partial loss. You can see the roof most of the time.
The peak of the hill is just west of the intersection. And that is the limiting factor for cars coming up. But if the knoll was dropped, it's not the knoll on the road that's getting in the way. It's the snow that's off the side of it. In other words.
When I was out there, I didn't notice it was the knoll. I was noticing just the fact that when I was looking out,
the road
finishing itself.
Right.
Yeah, I noticed that you were coming up towards that intersection. You're actually climbing a hill to get to the intersection.
Right, that's right.
I didn't realize it was that much of a hill until I got up and stood there. So.
Yeah. Anyway, when you're in a car, you're at 3.5 feet or whatever the ordinance wants you to be.
So
can see.
Well, actually, we were standing, so we were higher than.
Right, that's right.
So I didn't stoop down. There was no one when he's standing. I don't know what it looked like. I stooped down 3.5 feet.
Well, that's the survey. I mean, I don't know this guy. He's a reputable engineer. That's what he measured. And he got out there with his tape. That's what he came
out with. But he is measuring some significantly reduced sight distance to the movement all the way there.
Yes, that's right. This letter that I just got a hold of from the police department, I don't understand that, where they're coming up with that. I think if anyone went out there to look at it, it would be pretty obvious that taking a foot or 15 inches off of that, but you wouldn't be down to a level of that.
Mr. Chairman?
Or you certainly wouldn't be below that.
I'm not sure where all of this is going. Just some thoughts that aren't directly related to the issue, but I think interesting ones nonetheless. There's been no accident record at this intersection for the last 5 years. My assumption would be I had a hard time finding the road, to tell you the truth, when I was driving out to Life Road. I think that says something about the sight lines. And yet, on the other hand, there are no accidents there, recordable accidents, for the last 5 years. I think this is a classic example of a Cape Elizabeth road system that's so inherently dangerous that people take extra precautions before proceeding in that intersection. Secondly, we have a posted speed limit there of 35 miles an hour in one direction and 25 miles in another direction. And admittedly, the sight lines on this existing intersection, which has existed for some time, does not seem to be taken into consideration when posting those speed limits. That, to me, is a basic curiosity, because this is not an applicant coming before us for a large subdivision. This is an applicant coming in to build a single house, which adds one unit to, I believe, about 11 other houses on the street. I don't believe we're at a situation where we have a straw that's breaking the camel's back. I'm wondering if there's another consideration here, rather than going in and clearing out the right-of-way, doing things that generally destroy the character of this road and other roads in Cape Elizabeth, would it be feasible to post this as a dangerous intersection, a blind drive or whatever, and to reduce the speed limit at this location?
I think this would be on 25.
Mm-hmm.
We still have a practical problem of cars slowing down for 35 to whatever the next speed limit might be. That's still going to be a transition zone, so how much of an effect that'll have.
To me, it's a curiosity. It's a pre-existing condition that is already inherently dangerous, and yet the speed limit ignores the fact that there's a limited sight distance at this intersection. I don't understand how that works. It's not as if this road was built 5 years ago. This road has been there for a considerable length of time.
It's older than Two Lights Road. It's been there since they put Two Lights Road.
Any other comments on sight distance?
I appreciate those comments, because to me, a lot of the, it seems that these regulations that we're following are good regulations, and they seem designed for people to not abuse the system by putting in subdivisions and just putting a dirt road in. In this case, this road's been here for years and years, and I'm interested, you know, I bought the lot. I was told at the time that I would need a variance, but it wouldn't be a big deal. The realtor informed me that it was just a formality, you know. I said, you know, let's go for it. I'm paying a mortgage on the thing, and now I have to prove I have deeded access. I have to have a surveyor come out here and give me the site distance, and it seems, you know, I just want to build a house there. That's the land that I have. So I appreciate that point of view.
If we go, if we move on, Emory's we move on to another issue. What about the right of way thing?
Excuse me, the right of way.
The right of way, yeah. It is shown in various points on your sketch at various widths.
Right.
I know when we walked that road, there were a number of places where it looked like it was going over septic tank lines and other things. What is the story on the width? What can you tell us about the minimum access width that you have on that road?
Okay, the road, the narrowest the road gets is as it goes past the Clark property.
Right.
And the limiting factor at the time that I drew this map was these stones that were in the road. And that's what I was measuring to. Since that time, all of those stones have been removed except for one, which is near the line where her septic tank crosses the road. And she feels that cars and trucks go too fast through that area and that they've broken her septic line. So she doesn't want to remove this last rock, but it makes them slow down. Then they have to go slow. And there's also, she's built up, she's trying to cover over the line, so there's like a hump there, which also slows traffic down. It's like an effective speed bump type thing. On an old map, it shows the right-of-way there as being 40 feet wide, and I don't know how that, I can't imagine that it would be 40 feet. And no one that lives on the road wants the road to be wide like that. In terms of what is it wide enough or isn't it, the fire chief has no problem with the width of the road. He did request that the rocks be removed from it, and I think that that's a reasonable request. And I think if the shrubberies remain trimmed on either side of the road, that it is adequate distance to get safety vehicles up the road. Certainly is not adequate by the origin standards of
so that's really
22 another, feet or whatever they want.
That's another variance item that we're looking at. So now the question is it adequate for emergency vehicles?
Right. And according to the fire chief, at least, it is. And this, again, is a point. If it's not safe for my house to be there, is it safe for the 11 other houses or whatever on the road? In some ways, I feel that this isn't something that I should be taking care of. It's either safe or it isn't safe, and is it my responsibility to widen an existing road because I want to add a house to the road?
Mr. Chairman, maybe just to deal with two issues. There's two. One is the width of the right-of-way. The other issue is the width of the traveled way. Two different things. So really with most people consider to be the roadway is one aspect, and that's where it seems to go down to 10 feet in width. And Mr. Dorsey is correct that the fire chief said that the existing width that stands now would be adequate if all the rocks were removed. Most have been removed. That final rock probably needs to be removed, and then all of them have to be kept away from the traveled way. The other issue, though, is that the public access standards that would apply to a normal public access request talks about a 30-foot right-of-way at the minimum. From some information that Mr. Dorsky submitted, it looks as though in at least two spots, at least one spot, the right-of-way goes down from 40 feet down to 25 feet. It's unclear what the real right-of-way is. It seems like it's difficult, if not impossible, to research that through any normal tidal research methods. Another factor is we still don't know if the road, the existing traveled way, is actually located within right of way. We're taking a fair amount on faith. That's up to the board to decide. Is the current situation, the way everybody understands it, satisfactory to the board? If not, they want to waive some of those minimum standards below what's in the ordinance.
Mr. Chairman, could the planner read for all of us what those minimum standards are, and for the record?
Sure. I'll read them with the board needing to understand that because this lot, this public access waiver roadway, could serve three lots, that technically speaking, it has to meet all the subdivision standards, but the board can waive the subdivision standards down to whatever is appropriate. Feel that the public access waiver standards are appropriate, that would be that's what I'll be reading. And do you want me to read the whole section or just the numbered item?
I would paraphrase and just numbered.
Okay. Yeah. Paraphrasing needs to ask that the board consider future traffic over these sorts of roads. Talks about the provision or lack of provision of municipal services. Talks about compliance with the comprehensive plan, talks about the adequacy of the street construction proposed. In this case, there isn't any new construction proposed. Then it gets into the specific standards, which are as follows, and there's seven. One, minimum width of dedicated access right-of-way shall be 30 feet. Two, minimum pavement width shall be 22 feet. Three, paving shall be required for a distance of 50 feet from edge of street paving. Four, maximum grade of first 50 feet of drive shall be 2%. Five, pavement radius at intersection shall be 20 feet. Six, sight distance in each direction shall be 10 feet for each mile per hour of posted speed on receiving street, or if police records indicate actual speeds exceed posted speed, sight distance shall be based on posted speed or 80% of actual measured speed, whichever is greater. Sight distance shall be measured from a height of eye of 3.5 feet at a point located 26 feet from the center line of the road to an object 4 feet high located in the critical travel line. And seven, gutter drainage along the street shall not be allowed to sheet across the face of the intersection.
Mr. Chairman, could I ask questions specifically about each one? Minimum right-of-way of 30 feet, and in some cases it drops down to 25 feet.
In this case,
yes.
From the information provided, yes.
Minimum pavement of 22 feet, that refers only to the first 50 feet of pavement being required for paving.
Right, yes. The applicant stated he, at some point in the past, stated that he might be willing to do that perhaps, but didn't feel that was necessary. I'm not sure what Mr. Dorsey's current thoughts are on that. Whether or not he would want to do that for the first 50 feet of the roadway.
Well, let me react to it. Just comment on the standards as we go through them. We had an issue a little while ago. Is it a public access waiver? Yes. Where we debated or discussed reducing the width of the paved area going in down to something less than 22 feet to protect the views and the aesthetics of the neighborhood. And we were told after the fact that we couldn't do that, we had to resurrect it. So I wouldn't think that there would be any doubt if we couldn't do it at one, I don't know how we can do it on the other one.
You can do it.
Can you just find that?
No. You can't do it if a public access waiver is for a road that or driveway that serves one or two lots. Can't be done. There's a strange feature in this section, however, that bumps once you enter into the subdivision standards, which is a roadway that serves three or more, which is what this would be, all of a sudden you are then able, according to the town attorney, you are then able to use the subdivision waiver provision, which you're not allowed, the board is not allowed to do at all for public access waiver serving 102. So, yes, you can do it for public access roadways to serve three or more lots. The question is whether or not you want to do that in this or future cases, or if you feel that what's here are the minimum standards. So that's why you couldn't do it in that in the one case where you could do it here.
There are all cases of distinction here that actually be more flexible here because it serves more lots for some strength.
That's
the way the law.
And we have a lot less site distance here than we normally do.
Yeah.
Grade maximum 2%, it's not over 2%.
Fairly flat, I think, okay.
The radius issue, just how it's configured at the end. And the 10 miles per hour for each, 10 feet for every mile per hour is the standard that's here and in our road standard. And the seventh one was what?
Gutter
drainage. How is that being handled, or is there any change to the proposal?
I'm trying to think. Is there a swale on either side of that road that you go into?
The paved road is higher than Beacon Lane by 8 inches or foot, I guess. But it's quite a bit higher.
Because the paved road is higher.
It's a two lights road.
That's right.
After it comes down, it's pretty much flat. You know, Beacon Lane, the dirt.
There would be sheet drainage from two lights over Beacon Lane.
Right.
But not the other one,
right?
Not the other one. The other line is public road. The public works director didn't anticipate any problem.
We had a letter from the neighbors there asking that the road not be paved. Was that letter written as a pavement for the whole road going in or just the entrance? It wasn't
the letter, clear. I think, said that they really don't want the road changed at all.
Have it right here. We do not see the need to have the gravel road paved, widened, or altered in any way, as we feel that to do so will attract more traffic to our road.
We also received a letter from Mrs. Clark, I believe, noting to you, Steve, I remember correctly, noting that there had been an increase in traffic already by her place.
People on the road complain that since there's been a sign saying Beacon Lane on the end of the road, there's been increased traffic. The tourists see the sign and they think the lighthouse is up there.
Mr. Chairman, maybe are we through the presentation?
I think we're through with the presentation and entertaining questions right now. Actually, we've been entertaining questions for a while, so I'd say we're through the presentation. Unless Mr. Zorsky has something else to add.
I don't think so. Let me just check. I think you know pretty much the history done. One thing I do want to kind of bring up and for the record is that if any variance is taken on this issue, I think there are people in the community looking at this as that you'd be setting a standard, or so someone else could come in here with the same kind of call and expect to get a public access waiver. And I think that my request is really a unique one. There's a road, an old road, that has two lots remaining. And the other lot is an acre, 1.4. I don't think it's a buildable lot. I think you need 2 acres.
Not for separate lots.
You know?
It's a grandfathered lot. It's a buildable.
Okay. I don't know who owns it or who has it. It's someone from out of state. I don't know if the septic's approved or anything like that. But there is another lot there. So certainly if they wanted to build, they could. They might say, well, you let him do it. But other than barring that situation, I think for other roads that are people coming in with other dirt roads, I don't think that you'd be setting any kind of precedent. It's a unique situation. There's already houses on this old road, and there's one lot there that's buildable at this time. And I'm requesting that I be able to build on it. I think I've done everything that the planning board has requested, and I think I've acted in good faith. I just hope the town takes everything into consideration, including the owners on the road, what they would like to see.
Mr. Chairman, if I can just then react and be quiet. there are a lot of situations in the town of Cape Elizabeth that will have a similar application. There are a lot of dirt roads, a lot of private roads that still have developable property on it. Those lots would not normally, by our ordinances, be allowed to get a building permit because they don't have any frontage on public road. That's why the public access waiver provisions were developed. They've been revised a couple of times, and they are the standards that we have as a planning board given by the town council. With that in mind, and with the issues of common sense and the issues of where we stand with the number of roads, there will be other instances where people are just unable to get the amount of right-of-ways, historically based right-of-ways, that are required by ordinances in 1990. I think the board has to look at those situations on a case-by-case basis to see what's appropriate and what is not appropriate. Then one has to test the minimum right-of-way to determine whether that's absolutely critical or whether something that was done decades ago is okay. The issues of the paving going in 50 feet for 22 feet wide may be appropriate for the public access waivers, as Mr. Butler has pointed out, but maybe not under the case where you've got an existing road serving a number of properties. And that doesn't bother me, frankly, that we wouldn't have pavements 50 feet in depth with 22 feet wide with the appropriate radius. Things that do connect, nor does the right-of-way concern me, is one planning board member on a road that's historically based and historically developed. My only concern is twofold. One is the safety issues, and I think I tend to be a little harder on this issue than maybe other board members who have already spoken, that notwithstanding the fact that there are properties that use this road and that have not been in the accidents, this board is saying go ahead and put another house in if you don't have the site distances that are required by ordinance. And I would think that I could not vote for something that could potentially be a safety hazard. If it's achievable, if the 350 feet is achievable, then I think that it should be achieved. And the only way I would vote tonight for public access waivers is with assurances that that 350 feet can be achieved. It was also a recommendation earlier for moving the signs. I think that's a good idea to move a 25-mile-an-hour sign a couple of hundred feet up the road and get the speed down to 25 miles an hour might be an issue that is a very inexpensive way to help prevent any safety problems at the intersection. It appears that the 350 feet is achievable. There may be some character changes. There is a requirement that the town will have to give the applicant permission to do that. But I would hope that our motion shows that that's what would be required by this planning board, not only in this application, but in the other applications that will surely face over the speed for site distance. The other issue is the drainage, and that almost becomes a safety issue at some point where there may be drainage changes that are made. In this case, I don't think that is the case. This property to be developed is way back inside the existing road. I'm not sure that that much can be done, nor would there be any changes to the existing drainage at the entrance. So having said that, I'll wait for the moment.
Any other comments from hearing none, our planner has drafted a motion for us. At this point in time, I'd like to entertain a motion on this issue.
Mr. Chairman, perhaps before a motion is made, just to clarify the suggested motions for those planning board members, 2A is a suggested motion to grant public access waiver. 2B is on, it starts on page 2. There's a suggested motion to deny, and each of them have suggested findings of fact along with the decision and some conditions. So you, if you haven't had a chance already, you might want to take a moment to just look those over.
I would suggest that. Have you had a chance to review it? If so, do I hear a motion?
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
In order that the planning board makes the following findings and decisions regarding the request of Kevin Zorsky and Elise Thibodeau for a public access waiver for one lot, map Q15, lot 66, located on Beacon Lane. Beacon Lane, not Lighthouse Point Road.
Beacon Lane is what it's called.
Shall I read the findings of facts?
Yes.
The applicants own a lot on the unpaved portion of Beacon Lane, which is a private road. B, the applicants are required to apply for a public access waiver since their lot does not have frontage on an accepted public way. C, the proposed public access waiver roadway will serve more than three lots, which means that the road street design and construction standards contained in section 16-3-2 apply to the applicant's proposed roadway. D, because of practical and legal difficulties, the applicants cannot meet the standards contained in section 16-3-2 of the subdivision ordinance. E, the applicants are eligible for a waiver from section 16-3-2's street design and construction standards if the waiver provision of section 16.3.5 can be met. F, the proposed public access roadway meets the waiver provisions of section 16.3.5 because the proposed roadway, one, will not create more hazardous traffic conditions or less sanitary sewage disposals condition than strict compliance. Two, will secure substantially the standards of street design and construction required by the subdivision ordinance. And three, will not have the effect of nullifying the intent and objectives of the comprehensive plan or the subdivision ordinance. Be it therefore ordered that the request of Kevin Zorsky and Elise Thibodeau for a public access waiver for one lot, map U15, lot 66, located on Beacon Lane, be granted according to section 19-4-2B of the zoning ordinance and section 16-3-5 of the subdivision ordinance, and the facts presented subject to the following conditions. A, that a minimum improved and maintained roadway width of 10 feet along the entire length of the approved public access waiver roadway between Two Lights Road and the future house location be provided at all times by the present or future property owners of this property. B, that the public access waiver roadway shall be maintained and kept passable for emergency vehicles access purposes on a year-round basis. C, that the measurements for the Beacon Lane Two Lights Road intersection site distance as prepared and stated by Advanced Engineering Incorporated in their August 2nd, 1990 letter shall be submitted for review and approval by the town engineer and town planner prior to the issuance of a building permit. And D, that the rocks recently located within the Beacon Lane right-of-way shall not be placed within the public access waiver roadway at any future point in time. E, that a legally binding prohibition on blocking or parking within the Beacon Lane right-of-way shall be obtained by the applicants or future owners from all property owners with rights to the Beacon Lane right-of-way, and shall be submitted for review and approval by the town attorney and town planner prior to the issuance of a building permit. F, that this public access waiver shall be granted for only one single-family residence to be constructed on said lot, map U15, lot 66. G, that all other pertinent local, state, and federal approvals shall be obtained by the applicants or future owners prior to the issuance of a building permit. H, that the requirements of this approval shall be binding upon the present and future owners of the affected lot. And I, that a covenant incorporating the above-mentioned conditions shall be inserted into the deed of this property. Said covenant shall be submitted by the applicant or future owners for review and approval by the town attorney and town planner, and then recorded by the applicant or future owners with the Cumberland County Registry of Deeds prior to the issuance of a building permit.
Motion has been made. Is there a second?
Second.
There is a second. The motion has been made and seconded. It's now open for discussion.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Which of these conditions requires the provision of 350 feet of site distance on public right-of-way land by the applicant? I don't think there are any. I wouldn't ask the question.
Item C.
Can you condition
item C alludes to it, but it doesn't require it.
Mr. Chairman, I have some suggested language to add to C if I could. And that would read, and that the applicant will achieve 350 feet of site distance to the west prior to the issuance of the building permit. That would require how the applicant would do it, communicating with the town planner and town engineer, and then achieving that 350 feet.
Is that amendment acceptable to the proposed motion maker first and second?
Well, I don't know if it's consistent with what we discussed about perhaps posting the speed limit at 25 miles an hour in each direction, perhaps reducing it to 250 feet.
That requires that would require a speed survey moving the sign and then a speed survey to determine whether it's being met.
But if I understood correctly, the data that was presented by the applicant was that the current site distance, with none of this done, is 158 feet. So we're not even at 250 yet. We're at 158. Keep that in mind. No plan presented by the applicant that shows what could happen if it was done. So we're at 158 feet right now, as you said.
I would also request as part of that that if we're referring to advanced engineering, that they provide a sketch along with the weather right, so that we understand what they're doing.
Or so, Mr. Chairman, just to clarify, is Mr. Kinsman's motion then in addition to the others that are listed?
Yes.
But
it's an amendment.
It's an amendment which has not been accepted yet.
And would the amendment want to be tied to it being done prior to the issuance of the building permit?
Yes.
And actually, Mr. Chairman, I think you might want to be sure that the actual site distances are accurate in both directions, not just the left.
Right. I agree. So we have a proposed amendment that talks to the site distance being guaranteed, so to speak. Do you accept that amendment?
Yes.
Okay. Second.
Yes.
So we have an amendment. Okay. Any further discussion?
Yes.
Mr. Chairman, with respect to item B, point of clarification, really, I have some suggested language for clarifying about the rocks. I would propose that instead of the language that was read, that we would say that the large rocks currently located within the Beacon Lane right-of-way shall be removed, and that no other rocks shall be placed within the public access waiver roadway at any future point in time.
Once again, do we have any problems with that language?
I'm wondering that the road is only 10 feet wide that we're talking about as part of the accessible. It seemed to me that within the right-of-way or within perhaps a wider distance than that, the snow removal and proper access shall not be placed within 2 feet or shall not be placed within the right-of-way.
That may not be possible. I suspect the snow is within the right-of-way right now. That's probably true.
within the right of way, not within the travel way, but they were certainly within the right of way.
That's the rhythm.
At least they were, I kept them when I walked.
Yeah, because the right of way was quite long for you.
So I guess the question is, you'd like to see them within the right of way, which means that they have to be in the current condition area. They're currently in the right of way.
But it said it used to be located in the right of way, I guess that was my question.
Yeah, right.
Mr. Chairman, is this the question then, is it right of way or traveled way? Well, because I think the clarification about recent, current, you know, I think the issue or the primary concern of the fire chief was if there aren't any rocks that impair, actually, from the traveled way, I think that the suggested language makes sense, and perhaps if the concern is traveled way, we just change substance traveled way from right of way. Mm-hmm.
Is that acceptable?
Yes. Okay.
Acceptable. Now, I have a question on parking on this roadway. It seems to me as I walk that evening, we could get by, but there were cars that looked like some of those residences did not have garages, is that correct? Then there's a little foggy on it.
Two of the houses do not have garages, but they do have driveways.
Do have driveways off from that traveled way.
I mean, one of the houses has a driveway up Two Lights Road that isn't used, and a garage there. This is the Clark property, and she parks off of the right of way next to her house. I don't know how to describe it better than that.
Because I remember seeing cars along the road there that were not in driveways, or they seemed to be along the road as I remember walking by there.
I don't think so. Mrs. Clark's car was
along the road.
The road. But the only other cars along the road were, you know, yours and whoever else.
Well, maybe it was just her. I guess one question I would have for you, some of these guys that were talking about moving or neighbors achieving agreement on, is it practical to expect that agreement would be achieved?
I think everything is...
Are we asking for things here that are just not possible?
I think everything is fine. I don't really understand letter E, what my responsibility would be there. Am I responsible to get everyone to sign something?
That's what it says.
Well, then, okay.
A legally binding prohibition of blocking or parking, that's my concern, within the Beacon Lane right away shall be obtained by the applicants or future owners.
Okay. I don't know if that's going to be a problem or not, but again, because this is an existing road and this is concerns a question of safety, I don't really see why it's my responsibility to get everyone to agree not to park in the road. If that's causing an unsafe condition, it seems that the town should request that.
Yeah, I think one of the things you have to have clear in your mind, you are coming before us. The planning board doesn't review, unfortunately or unfortunately, existing conditions.
Right.
Certainly we're going to have an item on our agenda tonight called infrastructure. So we do review existing conditions on public roadways that we consider are not up to par. Mm-hmm. We are going to be making some recommendations to the town council to approve some of those. But most of the time, we review conditions when applications are made. So while you feel you're on the hot seat, maybe unjustly, that unfortunately is the way the process works. Mm-hmm. And I really can't say much more about it than that. Yeah, there have been houses there. We can't speak for what other planning boards have done in the past. We have to look at the ordinances that exist today. We have to look at the condition that exists today. And we have to match the two up and say, does this make sense? Is this a variance that in our minds we can go with? You know, unfortunately, you know, it may not be fair, but unfortunately, we're not looking at what's going on before. That's my feeling on the matter, and I think that's why we'll go back to where we are.
Okay. Then the only other question I have on letter E is, as was found out when I did the deeded access, I only have access from the one direction. Mm-hmm. Would I be required, and in effect, we found out that there's two streets there, a paved portion of Beacon Lane and a dirt portion, but legally two different streets. And those people on the dirt portion do not have access on the paved portion.
My understanding is that paved portion has been closed off in consideration a long time ago. We've kind of locked that up.
Well, my question is, do I need permission from those people on the pavement or just from those people?
I think we're considering it up to your lot, from the lights road up to your lot.
Okay.
That's what this is all concerned about.
Okay, well, doesn't say that, that's fine.
That may be something you want to clarify either as part of the minutes or as an amendment. So if the word that way, that's a good point. Otherwise, the applicants would have to go all to the entire length of Beacon Lane because those, all those people allegedly have the right to travel in one direction on Two Lights Road, but not necessarily.
Well, between my lot and Two Lights, there's just two other houses. One of them is not occupied at this time, and the house is for sale. So I'm not sure how I'd go about getting that sign.
Like a current owner for a door.
Okay. Or in plot or something, I guess I could do. Okay.
Mr. Chairman, maybe another question is here, as with condition D, you want to state right-of-way or travel-of-way? I think the fire chief was primarily concerned with travel-of-way, so I just want to make sure.
My thought would be travel-of-way. I don't know what those people are doing.
My only comment is, Steve, is that if you've got a car, theoretically can be up to the travel-way, and you're only leaving 10 feet, there's absolutely no clearance for that vehicle to get by. 10 feet, I mean, the fire chief is a fire chief, but 10 feet for an emergency vehicle is already extremely narrow. In my experience, it's somewhere around 17 feet. And it may be the reality that... I think that's very, very tight.
Yeah.
Perhaps within 2 feet of the traveled way, which is typically...
Well, seeing that the right-of-way is fairly narrow anyway, maybe we should do that with the right-of-way. We're not talking about a lot of right-of-way.
Well, that would be a problem for Mrs. Clark, because she is parking in the...
In the right-of-way.
In the right-of-way, I think so. I would like to point out that those small distances of 10 feet, they were limited by the rocks in the road. And if the rocks are removed, automatically the road is widened.
To what?
I didn't measure it that way, but 11 or 12 feet.
We're still not talking about a lot of margin. We're talking about a lot of things here.
No.
I guess... I don't know what to say. I think
Could it be worded in some way that the road is always clear, that a 10-foot or 12-foot path lane is always clear?
That's already stated in the commission. Right?
Okay. Or could that be somehow incorporated in these? So there's no parking within that 12-foot or 10-foot, whatever the number. I don't know how else to go about it. If it remains right of way, that's Mrs. Clark won't be able to park if she comes and parks. I think this is fair.
Or you won't get her again.
Mr. Chairman, why don't we insert if the motion maker wants to provision in there there'll always be a passable surface from any parking vehicles, however it wants to word it, for 15 feet.
That a legally binding prohibition on parking, blocking or parking within the Beacon Lane right-of-way shall be obtained by the applicants or future. That legally binding prohibition on blocking or parking within the right-of-way that 15-foot wide travel way shall be maintained.
Well, we said, what about this? Suggestion that the legally binding prohibition on blocking parking within the Beacon Lane travel way defined as a roadway with 10 feet plus 5 feet. 15 feet. We said a legally binding prohibition of blocking or parking within the Beacon Lane right away, which would be the minimum of 15 feet.
condition, I just wanted to make sure that that's intended. The paving of 22 feet, the first 50 feet, which would like to go back to Beacon Lane. Right now, as it stands, that wouldn't be required.
Refresh my memory. I don't recall if the pavement from Two Lights Road extends to the right-of-way line. Is there an issue of gravel kicking up at that intersection at this point?
I don't believe so. I think it goes almost directly up to your paved portion of Beacon Lane.
Any further discussion? Hearing none, I think we'll call for a vote on this as the motion was made. The other plans and facts on the record. I would call for a vote. All those in favor of the motion, please write your right hand. All those opposed? Passes 3-1. Do you understand the conditions?
Yes.
I suggest you correspond with the planner on the success of obtaining various legal issues.
Okay. I'd like to thank the planning board for taking their time to review this.
On to item 3 on our issue, Michelle Paul Sear, daycare facility for 9 children on 95 Lighting Lane. Once again, could you please come up to the hot seat? Or the safer?
Hopefully it's a little simpler.
We have received your application, and it's my understanding that the make is complete. Can you just give us a quick review on?
Yeah, sure. Okay, 2 meetings ago, there were a few items missing from the site plan submission. So prevented the application being deemed complete by the board. Those items seem to be submitted by the applicant. I think that the major area where there were questions regarding how were the children dropped off in terms of parking, traffic circulation. The applicant submitted a sketch showing the driveway area, how many cars could be parked within it, where the children wait for bus, and talk about the schedule as to when children were normally dropped off and picked up by families, both during the summer and during the fall. The other issue, major issue that was outstanding, was the question of right title and interest, and whether or not the actual owner in the property, Cindy Leiden, had knowledge of what was being proposed and whether or not she agreed to all of it. Having talked with her, she agreed to become a party to the application. So it's really now an application by Michelle and Paul Sear and Cindy Leiden. So with that all said and done, it appears as though, from my perspective, the application is complete.
Mr. Sear, is that right?
Yes.
Are you willing to add to what you said as far as the
No, not really. I think we've got all the bases covered.
Okay. And now we'll board back. Are there any questions on this by any of the planning board members?
I hate to be a nitpicker.
Go right ahead.
But why change now? Steve, how does one, right title and interest is a fairly legal document, say the least. And then one becomes a party in the application simply by a handwritten letter that's not notarized or anything else. Is that typical practice for the town, or should we have a letter before us from Cindy J. Leiden that is notarized?
I'm not sure there is any normal practice up to this point. We see all different levels, depending upon what's being proposed. More substantial and sophisticated and new construction items, something brand new, site plan, would say usually deeds recorded, notarized. case that that wasn't provided. By having talked with Mrs. Leiden and then subsequent, where she agreed verbally over the phone to become a party, she didn't see any problem in the follow-up letter. Made me think that was sufficient, but that's really something for the board to decide. In this case, that's adequate or something perhaps more legally definitive on that would be required.
I don't have any misgivings in this particular situation, but I can imagine other situations where it would be important to have a letter notarized.
Any other questions or comments? Hearing none, I entertain a motion.
Be it ordered that the site plan review application for the Sierra Day Care facility located at 95 Leiden Lane and proposed by Paul and Michelle Sear and Cindy Leiden is deemed to be complete in accordance with section 19-2-9 of the zoning ordinance and the facts presented.
We're voting on completeness first. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Okay. Any discussion on completeness issue? All those in favor, signify by raising the right hand. Opposed? Passes unanimously. Now we'll vote we'll entertain a motion, I should say, to the issue of acceptance of this.
Mr. Chairman, be it ordered that the request for site plan approval for the Sears Daycare facility located at 95 Leiden Lane proposed by Paul and Michelle Sear and Cindy Leiden be granted in accordance with section 19-2-9 of the zoning ordinance of the tax of the
Is there a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor, signify by raising the right hand. Opposed? Passes unanimously. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Next item on our agenda, moving right along, is under a new business item, is an application from Casper Northern Bank for an addition to the existing bank building at 1234 Shore Road. Site plan review of section 19-2-9 of our ordinance. Is there a representative of Casco Bank here to make a presentation? Would you please come up to the seat here and identify yourself for us?
Okay.
There is a stand for a hard tag.
Right.
You could use our board for that.
My name is Bob Cody. I'm with Casco Northern Bank. I'm the real estate office. Casco is proposing to enclose a portico. Enclose a portico that we now currently have that's approximately 132 square feet, 6 feet deep, and 22 feet in length. There'll be no elevation change whatsoever to the base or the top of that portico. Right now it is bituminous. We propose to change that to a cross wall and poured concrete and leave it the same elevation. The only change that we also propose, which are in the packets, would be to enclose the portico in glazing. And we plan to do that with white exterior framing so that the addition would blend in well to the colonial design and appearance of the building. One other plan that you have before you, and we'll come back to this plan in a few minutes. I've asked Steve Bell, who's done the landscape architecture for the proposed site, the additional landscape architecture for the site, to address those changes. I'll kind of hold this plan up. This is a plan that you have that shows all the abutting property within the 200-foot radius of our property on Ocean House Road and Corner Shore Road. These are the changes that we're proposing. Currently, there are two parallel parking spaces on this line of entry, and we propose to delete those two parking spaces. By deleting those two parking spaces, we will improve our traffic flow, because what we're proposing also is to take all traffic that enters the facility and that would like to park in front of the building rotate around the building to the front, as well as Kunzlock Shore Road. All traffic coming from the parking lot towards Ocean House Road would be going only in one direction. It would be properly signed saying exit only, so no traffic would be creeping up in this direction. Also, the car spaces are angled in order to make it extremely difficult for anyone coming in this way in the front. We propose to, we do currently have a handicapped space, and by improving our entry, that will improve our handicap accessibility to the building. Those, I believe, are the only site plan changes that we have. We propose not to change any of the exterior lighting to the building or signage that is to the building, except for relocation of the Castor Northern Bank sign that we found out after survey is slightly off the property line. Why is that not a surprise? So I'll ask Steve if you would like to make any comments about the landscape plan, the proposed landscape plan.
My name is Steve Doyle. I'm from Sebago Technic. I just want to go over the landscaping that's out there. Currently, what you see around the building...
Excuse me, sir. Your last name was?
Doe.
D-O-E.
The landscaping around the building, as well as these trees located here, are existing. These are well-maintained. They are very mature plants. And the bank felt there was no need to really improve that area due to its... well-maintained character and the appearance of mature planting. There is some additions that we have had on the plan. We are proposing to put a rail fence along the front here, and it'll continue along the property line here and then just turn the corner. And there's a wood rail fence which will be painted to match the architecture of the building. And there's a little detail of it in the corner here, which I believe you have the plan. In addition to the fence along the front, we're proposing to add 72 daylilies, which will provide some nice color. I don't believe you have that on your plans. This was a recent change I added after talking with Steve Butler. These plants will provide a screen and also provide some nice color for that intersection and this area around here. Other than that, that is the only landscape we're proposing. Everything else is existing and in good condition.
Any further presentation? Any questions from the board? Well, good back. Well, I'll start it off. What about lighting the area? This is now going to be an ATM. I assume it's going to be accessible 24 hours a day?
That's correct.
What will you be providing for lighting?
We're proposing no additional change. Currently, we have a night depository on this portico, which is available for 24-hour use. And we, for our security, for our customers' safety, we have already a high-pressure sodium light fixture at the front of the building that's already addressing the front of the parking lot along with the illuminated Castor Northern Bank sign. The back of the parking lot, to take care of the rotation of the traffic, we do have a pole lamp on the back side of the property, along with a high-pressure sodium lamp right under the canopy on this corner of the building, shedding light over in this direction. There are a few landscape lighting fixtures that are located here, shining onto the building, and directly here, and this half round that's shining onto the building. We're proposing actually no additional lighting. We're taking some lighting level checks, and the levels are well within about 1 or 2 foot candles in this area.
Yes. How is it illuminated now through the day?
All the light fixtures that I mentioned are currently present. Most of them are controlled by a light sensor, so a photocell, so they would go on along with us.
And they're on all night long?
That's correct.
I assume the interior area, the elevation that we see on drawing A1, I guess, shows a white thick insulated glass portico. That'll be all open.
make it invisible to the street for security.
Absolutely.
So you'll be able to see it.
What, we've also relocating our Truman, I'm sorry.
No place to hide.
That's right, no place to hide. Right now, customers enter the bank right at the door. And there's very little use of the portico. In fact, the door sweeps out and you have to back up away from the door. The plan shows that the entry will be dead center of the portico. So the customer then could enter either right or left. If you enter left going to the bank during the day or right going to the ATM machine. And it'll give us a little bit better ramping, bringing up the grade to the portico height. So it'll be in conformity with about 1%.
Will it be handicapped accessible?
Yes, it will. We currently are handicapped accessible, but we're truly not meeting that grade here. That's a very steep, really steep grade, probably 2-3%. So we're proposing to bring that up to come in this direction, come up to that center door, and improving that grade.
I guess I missed the comment about reconfiguration of the parking.
To
orient in the opposite travel direction.
Okay.
How does that work?
Okay, currently the number of parking spaces is at 15. And we want to delete two parallel parking spaces that are this location, opening up the travel, opening up more distance and width from this island for traffic to flow. Currently, cars are allowed in this area to go in either direction. It's too narrow to go in either direction, and the way the automobile spaces are lined, they're not made for anyone coming up in this direction to come into the parking space in front. So we will properly sign this, not two negatives, but as exit only, and bring the traffic into the building and circle around to get into this spot if they're coming in from Ocean House Road. Those coming from Shore Road would have the trouble of either driving left to the Ford building or the back of the building. We find mostly our employees parking here and customers rotating in and out and utilizing the spaces in the front.
Same number of spaces over there.
Same number of spaces. Spaces, excuse me.
You said you removed two spaces. How are you maintaining the same number of spaces?
Oh, I'm sorry. We have the same number of spaces in the front of the building, but we are deleting two spaces in the overall plan.
And Steve, how does that meet with zoning requirements for this use and square footage?
I'd have to calculate it out. Quite frankly, I wasn't aware that they were limiting two spaces. I think they're satisfied with that.
In terms of the striping, I don't know. It seems as though the striping should be included on the plan if that's a proposed change.
The striping is on.
Oh, it's on the existing. Okay.
What they didn't show is they didn't show the deletion.
Well, they are gone, essentially, the grades. They are off at this plan that shows the 200-foot radius to the property. The point that those spaces are non-existent on this plan. We do not have noted on either plan, and should be noted by the board, of the need for a sign that say takes it on. We are going to have that line that only helps us in part of the year, not very well in snow cover.
Where are those spaces currently that are being deleted?
There are two parallel parking spaces right here.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, on this
line.
Simply
going to open that up for
that's right. We'll blacken those out.
While you're on that subtle advantage, yes. I noticed just is from the landscape architect, the wood rail fence shows that shows an outline of a driveway. You certainly have offensive right to put that fence along the way, but that boundary, is that going to cause any trouble with the current use of that building next door?
We hope not. We are holding the fence back a few 2 feet from the property line on the side, allowing them enough space to rotate on that corner. And this has just been ongoing encroachment over the years.
Mr. Chairman, I mean, just to clarify that point, that's something that wasn't on the current plan. There may be something that was changed on the plans that are shown, but the existing landscape plan actually shows the fencing protruding a little bit over to the traveled way near the back corner. So, I mean, I would applaud the applicant's you're looking at, but that's probably something that shouldn't be shown.
Yes.
I have one more question. Who is Earl W. Watson III?
Okay. Earl is a designer who lives in Portland, who did the elevation drawings for the building for the existing elevations. So it shouldn't be.
Have you done an estimate of the cost of the improvements that you're proposing?
Yes, the improvements that we've estimated, not counting the cost of the machine, the ATM machine, is around $9,000.
For the glass enclosure?
That's correct. Yeah, we bought on bid. I did three branches at one time and picked up a pretty good deal on the glazing.
Well, you haven't kicked in $150,000 of a $100,000 improvement, obviously, but you show a 5-foot ramp. If it's a handicap ramp and it's sloping 1 and 12, then I think it should be, I'm assuming it's a 6-inch curve, maybe it's a 2-inch curve, I don't know. But perhaps that ramp needs to be a little wider than the fancy standards. And I can't remember whether the landing for a handicap ramp has to be 3 feet wide or 5 feet wide. I would only suggest that if that's an appropriate part of our site plan review process, that we ask the applicant to review that with the code enforcement officer prior to issuing the building permit.
Yeah. The wheelchair can turn around in a 4-foot area. So a 4-foot typically is wide enough for a handicap.
Yeah, I've seen, but I don't remember the type of thing. It's something that should be checked.
I would request, gentlemen, speak up to you, put a little mic here that we normally would have, so I don't know whether we'll do up or not. Yeah, I think the handicap access certainly is an important point. Any comments from the board on the proposed landscaping plan? Currently, I guess it's just a banking out there, but I come out of the area. They're now proposing bailiffs, is that right? How high will they go?
Bailiffs, it's a perennial plant. And it will come up and then it will die down in the winter. You're going to have snow there, so you're not going to see them anyway. As far as the height, the vegetation will grow probably 18 inches in height. And then from the top of that, you'll get your flower stalks to go another 2 feet, 3 feet. So the total, actually the flower height will probably be 3 foot.
You're probably aware across the street now for the planning review process and improve their property. Planters, or annuals and planters. This is different from all of that. This is different than what we have in California. What is the planning board to do about
Mr.
that?
Mr. Chairman, I like it. I think both the fence and the flowering, the perennials are a nice way of treating a very sensitive site. I think the jury is still out on those individual planters that we now have across the street, whether those are a long-term objective or not. I like what we see here. And I think it should be noted, and maybe I'm the only one on the planning board that knows it, and that's that Casca Bank donated 2 trees to the town tree warden a couple of months ago. In the ceremony, I think that the high school kids or the grade school kids planted those to red maples, I believe, as I remember. Trees, so it's not an attempt to cut back. I think it's a very sensitive treatment of the site. I think we should consider the fence and the flowering as the landscape portions, not just what's growing there. I think the fence will look real nice.
I think it will too. I didn't mean that in a negative fashion. I'm just asking this comparison. So it's on Main Street, and I use committee to town, so we are trying to improve our downtown. This will do it.
Mr. Chairman, just so you know, Main Street 90 County Center Subcommittee met this morning, although I didn't talk directly with the chair, and that I understood that they wanted more than was proposed originally to the fence. They're not aware of the planting scheme. I think they indicated they would like to have some input into this whole process.
I can't fight that on my subcommittee's.
They do have some comments about the planters, but we'll let
we'll talk about those the other
day. We're still not positive.
The jury is still out, Mr. Chairman.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman.
comments, and I guess they're all in the comments. Number one, I think it's a very nice design. It's an improvement for that corner. My comment is more about what the town can do and what we're looking to do in that intersection that relates to the infrastructure. We'll report on later. One thing that I've noticed in having tried to get to that spot is that it's almost impossible pedestrian traffic. So I get stranded on that little island up there, and I didn't think I'd ever get off it. Yes, exactly. I hate to help. Yeah, I want to get over there. Not something I'm looking for the applicant to do, but something that I think we need to look at as a planning board is how can we improve the pedestrian traffic to not only this site, but other sites around that intersection. It's a real tough intersection. My only other comment had to do with the white tubing, and we're getting really picky, but everybody in that whole square that's come before us in the last few months has been scrutinized closely. And the white tubing, the white aluminum tubing, strikes me of the 1950s strip mall. Might just suggest the bronze type aluminum or something.
The reason we went with white.
You do have white trim, I know.
It's more colonial.
It's a good sale on it.
$9,000 sale on it, yeah.
I wish
go with it.
I wish it was the case. Of course, that's more expensive. But we did that in Scarborough, whatever, when we closed this. It's just a little, it doesn't show up. The two aluminum and the bronze tend to say, geez, you know, the stock spot, everything then blends in with the white trim and the shutters and the colonial atmosphere in terms of the building. That's the only thing.
Any other comments?
Well, I'll add my comment, which is when I first opened the packet, I said, aha, there's another candidate for landscaping. Looking at what we've done with Balfour and Jonesy's, and I was very pleased with what you did. It took me a while to figure out what you were going to do. Because it looked the same from the top as it had it, and then I realized it was the ATM enclosure. And I'm thrilled about the daylilies, because I've tried on the other two to get them to plant perennials. I think it'll look great. Yes, you do. You do have the lawn, which wasn't available, and it really
helps to find the property.
It does.
Any other comments?
Mr. Chairman, I can ask the applicant what the square footage of the building is. I'm doing some rough estimates, and the numbers don't look good.
38-44. So this cost.
No.
Well, can you give me a break to calculate?
Yeah. So it's a one-story building? With the enclosure, it'll be 38.
Right, it's on a slab.
Yeah, it looks like about 38-40.
I don't do well in this pressure.
Yeah, it's 38-44.
38-44.
Okay, that's the... Any storage areas?
No, it's a slab. It's on a slab.
No,
storage areas on the first
no.
building?
No.
What about the vault?
Oh, I'm sorry. The entire, we're using the entire footprint of the
building.
But is this
involved?
These
stairs are
well, we have
just
in the right
walls.
Okay, if it's 38-44, then they need 11 spaces and they seem to have 13.
13.
Get the two stories.
Let me reach out to you.
Any further comments? Hearing none, we have two issues on this application. Application complete, this is one, which after we get to the meeting tonight, that may not be one we'll be considering much anymore, but we do have application completeness on this. Mr. Butler, do you have any questions on the application completeness?
I think everything's been covered. Items were relatively small. Landscaping was an issue. Features off-site, 200 feet, I think that's a big item. Lighting was asked about this moved. And other clear question mark on easement. If there is an easement, there's this side concern about the driveway on the abutting property. Long as that reflected in the site plans and in the minutes, and maybe it's part of the approval. There is one. I think that would be appropriate. I don't think it makes sense to erect a fence that would cut off part of the existing use of the driveway. So I think in terms of completeness, if the board finds outstanding items to be relatively minor,
do I hear a motion from the board on the issue of completeness?
Chairman, be it ordered that the site plan review application for the addition to the existing Casco Northern Bank building located at 1234 Shore Road is deemed to be complete in accordance with Section 19.29 of the zoning ordinance and the facts of the matter.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Any further discussion on the completeness issue? Hearing none, I can call for a vote. All those in favor, signify by raising your hand. Opposed? Passes unanimously. We now need the application to be complete. We now like to hear a motion on the adequacy of the plan.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make that motion. I have some questions of Mr. Butler about the language. I don't think we need any further, now that we have a landscaping plan. And as chairman of the Main Street 90 Committee, I'd prefer to keep the Main Street 90 subcommittees out of a regulatory function, particularly since we'll be out of existence in 6 months, 5 months. Conditions then A, B, and C, or B, C, and D, what is the reason for that? We don't usually see these kind of conditions attached to site plan review. Is there a particular purpose that's specifically achieved?
We see more recently in the past year or two, year and a half, we've been seeing condition B, which is to make sure that down the road somebody doesn't submit another site plan and claim that there isn't anything preventing them from doing that. I don't think that would be a problem in this case, but it probably doesn't hurt to have this condition. C just states what
old C and new C.
Old C states clearly for everybody that for some reason ownership of the bank were of the property were to be switched, were to be changed, that the condition requirements that were being imposed still pertain to the future owners. And then D is something that's been done more recently just to make sure that's like the final legal nail, so to speak, just to make sure that that gets done.
Mr. Chairman, I'll make the motion. I don't think I'm going to add the A, B, and C in because they're all givens. You don't change the site plan without site plan approval in town, and they are binding on future owners. And then the last one, the covenant, is an important one if you've got particular conditions and you want them covenant on a legal document.
I think Mr. Butler is requested to make these suggested motions for our use, our consideration, and certainly if any motions that lack certain items of Mr. Butler's plan or change it totally, it's certainly a couple.
I guess I just
no
wanted to know.
At all.
Yeah, I just wanted to know why we're doing it.
Okay.
So, Chairman, maybe just to follow up on one point that Mr. Chin has been made, B and C aren't as the planning boards can't assume that that's something that just would occur in this recent court case in Portland. But that assumption was made, it turned out it was the church, went out, cleared the whole area of land, which on the site plan was shown to be wooded area, went to court, and the court said that unless there's something that explicitly stated or prohibited the owner from making those changes, they can do it. So that whole assumption is there. In this case may not be an issue, but that's one of the reasons.
If that's the case, I'll leave it.
Okay.
I don't want to debate it for a long time.
No choice.
That's the reason. With that, Mr. Chairman, be it ordered that the request for site plan approval for the addition to the existing Casco Northern Bank building located at 1234 Shore Road be granted in accordance with Section 19.29 of the zoning ordinance and the facts presented subject to the following conditions. A, that the entire site shall be developed as depicted on the presented site plan except as amended by these conditions of approval. Approval of the planning board shall be required for any alteration to or deviation from the approved site plan. B, that the requirements of this approval and the above mentioned conditions shall be binding upon present future owners of the site, and C, that a covenant incorporating the above mentioned conditions shall be inserted into the deed of this property. Said covenant shall be submitted by the applicant for review and approval by the town attorney and town planner, and then recorded by the applicant of the county register of deeds prior to the issuance of the building permit.
Thank you. Our second to this motion.
Second.
Second. Any further discussion?
Mr. Chairman, just again, a minor point. Maybe as long as part of that includes maybe a request by to the applicants to submit revised site plans showing what's been presented.
No amendment then. Any further discussion? Then I will call for a vote. All those in favor, signify by raising your right hand. Opposed? Once again, we have unanimous passage for this. Congratulations to the
Thank you very much.
Thank you for our sensitivity to our center town.
Well, we're pretty proud.
All right, we're moving right along, getting towards our, we're creating a new tradition here of getting out by 9 o'clock. I may get fired for not working hard enough. We have some items on our agenda that I would like to bring up at this time. One is setting a hearing for a proposed amendment to section 19-2-21, 19-3-1B, and 19-3-2B of our zoning ordinance regarding setbacks. So, Bobby, could you give us just a little bit of background on the setback issue? And,
I think this is something that came out of both some zoning board of appeals and some town council concerns about some of the items that were going before the zoning board with respect to some request for variances. So what they wanted to do was to allow as conditional uses rather than variances some additions to buildings that might intrude on setbacks. And a major item, major issue that has come up several times from what I understand before the zoning board was the whole issue of decks. And as of right now, the way I understand it, decks aren't specifically allowed in the zones, and therefore, if you want to add a deck that intrudes on a side setback, you have to go through the variance process, which is rather rigorous. So one of the suggestions is that decks be added as a use that would be allowed with conditional use permit under the Residence A, and therefore the Residence C district. Two other items dealt with setbacks or some slight additions to setbacks for new buildings, for new construction on existing buildings, and also for some setbacks to be allowed to occur on lots that now are substandard but were approved and built upon prior to the most recent lot size change. So that's what on page 25 and 28. Page 25 suggested changes would allow for some intrusion into the setback as long as it doesn't extend any further. It gets complicated. But, I'm not sure if you really want me to explain it at this point or not. It's something that works better with some sketches.
I think that maybe you don't have to go into the details now, but we certainly will probably want to have, I think, a detailed presentation if we decide to set a hearing at our next meeting, at that meeting for the purposes of both the planning board and the public to have a better view of what we're talking about before we finally go into the next issue. So
and
I would prepare for something like that.
I've talked to Ray McBain. He'll be preparing some sketches. And also, I've talked to Tom Leahy, the town attorney, and he is developing some minor word changes to tighten up the language legally, both of which will be made available to the board.
Steve?
Yes.
These setbacks are measured to a foundation or to what?
It's to most often a foundation, but it doesn't include decks. But if they extend out, there's some arcane language that refers to where support kind of touches down. I'm not quite sure what happens with cantilever decks. I believe they're covered. But it's, I think, any protrusion from the building is counted as being extending into the site back. So it's not necessarily just the basement or slab foundation with a lot of second and third story decks or what have you, balcony strips.
I don't want to take us on a diversion here, but it's my understanding, and I may be wrong, but it's my understanding that the ordinance setback is measured to the foundation, and that people initially were adding on such as bays and so forth by cantilevering, and the way the town got around that problem was that they required any addition to have a proper foundation, a crosswalk. I only raise the issue because I noticed in our site walk on First Atlantic that one of the houses that had an addition on the back appeared to have built it on top of a deck, and it appeared to be a rear year-round addition that was significantly cantilevered off the edge of the deck. So I don't, that issue maybe is important as the actual setback numbers themselves. If it were all possible to make the setback to the building line, whether it's the foundation or the nearest point of the building, I think that would make it much easier for everyone.
Okay, I'll check.
Any other discussion on this item before we make a motion to set a hearing date? Hearing none, we do have a suggested motion on the hearing for this amendment. Do you hear a motion? Applying to its item 7 on page 3 of our
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Be ordered the planning board will hold a public hearing on the proposed amendments of section 19.22L, 19.31B, 19.32B of the zoning ordinance relating to setbacks at the September 18th, 1990 planning board meeting.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any further discussion on this hearing? Hearing none, all those in favor, if I raise your right hand. Opposed? Passes. Now, this will be advertised for okay. My suggestion is, more, or there is an agenda item, I wanted to get this early on the agenda. Get it out of the way. Okay, last few items, and we want to go for the evening. Some new items, other business. First item on our list is a report from our infrastructure subcommittee, which has worked hard. I know I've been here for a couple meetings or other meetings, and they've been in there pounding away at it. Just for your reference, the subcommittee was Tom, Steve Edsel, and Judy, right? Let's get ready.
This side of the bench.
This side of the bench. This side of the bench is our subcommittee, and I don't know who is acting as chairman. Steve, could you just give us a short report?
Sure. Our initial intent was to gather information about needs in the overall infrastructure in the town of Cape Elizabeth, what we foresee as problems and needs created in the next 5 to 10 years, with the intent of developing some type of method to deal with infrastructure improvements on an ongoing basis. We met several times, identified different areas of need. And in infrastructure, we're talking primarily road construction. Did address sewer and water, some recreational areas, recreational access. And I don't believe the map is here, but Steve Butler is nice enough to create a map showing those areas. We have prioritized those, I think, in the report here and some of the, one of the memos that showed a matrix that Tom did, prioritizing those different areas of identified need. Basically, two ways to approach the correction as new development takes place in the municipality, the burden or part of the burden of improvements to be done can be awarded to the developers in those localized areas, or on an overall method that a certain amount of infrastructural work needs needs to be done during a certain period of time, and that any development to or in the town adds to that fund that, that is used to correct it. But I believe that the intent is also to take this to the town council to see how they'd like to handle, or if they'd like to see anything done.
That is the plan.
The map is now appearing as we speak.
And then we can point out the areas of, that have been prioritized for...
Okay. Prioritized areas seem to be two to three. One, I think, first one, one of the three, was the Route 77 Scott Dyer Road, Shore Road intersection. Another one was the reverse S-curve up on Mitchell Road. And the third one, which may need some clarification from the infrastructure subcommittee, was Shore Road. And I know the planning board workshop minutes talked about alignment issues concerned with certain sections of the Shore Road. There may be some areas that the infrastructure subcommittee might want to highlight. Those are the three major areas that were identified at the last planning board workshop. And there's many other areas that were identified as part of the infrastructure subcommittee.
There's also a matrix, if I'm not mistaken, that identifies all of these areas. I think it would be good to share that matrix with town council so they can see what the whole issue was and the rationale for choosing the top three.
Mr. Chairman, I had a question about one of them because it's right by my house, and that was Sawyer Road, Wells Road, the intersection. And that was in the matrix. What was the issue at that intersection? That was just redesigned and rebuilt 4 or 5 years ago, 10 years ago.
So my recollection is that to the south side of that is where the blind area coming up over the knoll, not necessarily blind, but it's a short sight distance. That's our favorite topic tonight. Well designed with a short sight distance approaching from the south.
Do you know what that site sounds like?
No, we didn't do any scientific or on-site measuring of any of these. We just simply spent a lot of time, the three of us riding around town. Then, yeah, these are problems. Some of them we didn't have to ride around town, so everybody knows them. The other question is, for instance, on Wells Road, you see in orange, there's, and I happen to go across there twice today. That was a question of the curves. It was just repaved and resurfaced, and then, but the curves and the slope of the road itself fits the wrong way in the curve. Those types of improvements are what we're looking at. What we prioritize were the areas of the greatest need, and that being our downtown area. We focus on the intersection of Shore, Scott Dyer, and 77, but there were, if you see below that, I think there were some other red circles. All the entrances onto 77, the high school, Jordan Way, the fire department, the high school, along this stretch are all concerns. The matrix was handed out tonight as part of it's the third page of the workshop meeting minutes.
It would probably be helpful, Steve, with the matrix, that if this goes to the council, that under remarks is some notation, some key indications to what each one of those refers to, or the inclusion of Steve's list. Would it probably would be make it clearer.
Yeah, and I also would like to make sure that when this recommendation goes to the town council, that the subcommittee members are mentioned, the town members who gets a week, are mentioned in that memo. I think what we've done here is some real life planning. I've been on the planning board for 7 years. I have seen very little real life planning. This is what this is. service. What I'd like to do at this point in time, we prepared a motion so that we can go to the town council with this officially. I don't know whether we have any, that we can do really much more than this at this time, since it's going to involve spending of town funds and budget considerations. It's going to have to get town council action in any case. So if you think with page 4 of our suggested motion, if there's no other discussion on this refined report, I would request that we move to make a motion. Pass this along to the town council. Here, the motion.
Mr. Chairman, I move that the order of the planning board makes the following recommendations to the council regarding Cape Elizabeth's infrastructure. A, that the planning board has identified 3 areas of the town as having the greatest infrastructure needs and recommend the town council take steps to address these needs as soon as possible. These 3 identified areas are as follows. 1, Shore Road, Scott Dyer Road, Route 77 intersection. 2, the reverse S-curve on Mitchell Road in the vicinity of Shepherd's Road. And 3, the alignment along certain roads of shore, certain sections of Shore Road. We probably need to be more specific about that. I'm entertaining this motion in a minute. B, the planning board has also identified other areas with infrastructural deficiencies which have been prioritized on a matrix that was prepared by the planning board infrastructure subcommittee. C, the town should investigate the feasibility of the impact fees or other types of mechanisms to have a proportionate share of the costs of these new infrastructure improvements borne by new development.
There is a question on A3, and I guess we'll go back to the infrastructure committee. What were you thinking about? Was it widening the road or straightening out curves?
I wouldn't I'd strike the word alignment from that statement. If you look at the matrix, in Shore Road, most of them are intersections. There are a number of different issues. I would simply, when we spoke the last workshop, we spoke of identifying 3 areas of need. One was number 1, that intersection. We picked or chose the curve at in Mitchell Road. There were a number of areas, the 2 intersections, one at Chevis and one at Route 77. And basically a number of different issues follow along the Shore Road, so I wouldn't necessarily focus on the alignment of the Shore Road.
It was, again, what we were doing was very subjective. And when we brought up and discussed the Shore Road bias, the way it is what makes it attractive, unique, interesting. It's what attracts people to it. It's not necessarily that the alignment needs to be fixed, but the alignment of it causes a number of problems, which may need to be addressed in another way. Some of those are the number of blind driveways, hills, and curves, which at Shore Road now is being more and more popularized by bicyclists. You come upon some of these curves and hills with nowhere to go. And you can't move around them because you're literally blind as to what's over the other bump. The traffic caused by the attraction of Fort Williams, tour buses, sometimes trying to get in and out of that particular intersection on Shore Road, particularly if you have tour buses and a little league game going at Family Field, the usual thing. It's not that the alignment needs to be fixed, but there are other problems that are not going to get any better. And we need to think about how we're going to do this, either a pedestrian or a bicycle walkway, which they've talked about. I suggested making it one way, as being a way to maintain it, reducing the speed limit. But we've got to do something. It's just going to get worse, and again, maybe it's going to be one of those things that as it becomes so bad, everybody ends up going 5 miles an hour, and it's self-fixing, but it's the alignment that causes the problems, not necessarily the alignment that needs to be fixed.
If I can understand that what you're saying, basically, there's a matrix of items on Shore Road, and what we really should be putting in there is the statement of the effect that that should be drawn to the matrix for all items issued, all issues raised, and maybe incorporate the matrix into the motion. Say that the right way?
Right, so even with the site places, the site views, you know, you come one through Pond Cove, and if you get behind somebody from out of town, they invariably slow down there or try to pull over, and there's no place to pull over, and it's, they're just good.
Mr. Chairman, there's something that Mr. Edsel mentioned, which maybe needs to be added in as well. I think the motion focuses in on that one intersection, the Shore, the 77, and perhaps at least the workshop, perhaps there was more discussion about it being a wider area, kind of a town center area, not just that intersection. I'm not sure if you want to make that distinction as part of your recommendation to the town council.
One problem I would have with that is if we'd like the town council to do something with our top issues, I think if you make it too broad, then they might just look at it, put it in their hand, and say we just can't do anything about it. Whereas if they're specific, I think you were specific about that intersection. Mm-hmm. I understand.
Yeah.
That's what I would be. I would vote to keep it to that issue right there. If they could look at the rest of the matrix items if they want to, they can serve the town center. But I like the idea of focusing.
We came up with these three unscientifically, just